So let's start the second class of this course, okay? And in this class, at the beginning, I try to give some applications of the Hayles identity, okay? First of all, if you have some question about the first class of yesterday, you can write here, okay? Or also during the class, you can write, okay? So just remember the last class. In the last class, we know about this really identity. And that's identity that you can use for, just to remember here, when you have a Riemannian manifold, okay, and a domain in this Riemannian manifold, what means a set or a compact set with a boundary, okay? And we have this integration formula, and that is obtained by integrating the Bochner formula, okay? And here we have this important relation. And just also to put here and to remember the last class, here we have the Laplacian and the manifold. And here, when I put this bar, is the Laplacian in this hypersurface at the boundary, okay? Here is the nomoderivative. And the nomoderivative is taken in with the external normal vector field, okay? Here we have the mean curvature, and here we have the second fundamental form, okay? Of this immersion of the boundary and the domain, okay? So the first proposal of this class is give some new applications. We already see one application that was the heights and catch inequality. So we try to give more application of this Riley identity. Okay, the first application is a result theorem by Choi and Wang, and is another application that is a estimate for the first eigenvalue of the Laplacian. Okay, so the situation is this. Let sigma n minus 1 be embedded hypersurface, embedded and minimal hypersurface and the n-dimensional sphere, okay? Then we have the following estimate for the first eigenvalue. The first eigenvalue of the Laplacian is greater or equal n minus 1 by 2, okay? Where lambda 1 is the first eigenvalue of the Laplacian, okay? What means that you are trying to solve a problem like I put here Laplacian bar, because this means the Laplacian for this hypersurface here, okay? And we are trying to solve a problem like Laplacian bar of f equal minus lambda 1 g, okay? And I try to get the last value when this happens here, okay? Basically is this. So this is a estimate for the first eigenvalue, okay? So normal time, we try to demonstrate this result, this estimate for the first eigenvalue, using the Riley identity, okay? So the idea, like in the case of heights and catch inequality, is try to use a special problem, okay? A special function, and apply in the situation here, okay? So what you can do here? First of all, an important thing here, just one hypothesis here, we need that this mini pool. The hyperscape is closed. An important thing here is that this is a geometric fact that I put here. If you have a closed embedded minimal hypersurface, in fact, in the sphere, there is a theorem, that's the Jordan-Brouwer theorem, that you can separate the sphere into parts, okay? So basically, this is the situation that happens here. If you have a hypersurface in this sense, this hypersurface divide the sphere into parts, okay? I'm doing this draw in the one-dimensional case, but it's similar. So here it's like we have this sphere. So we have this part here of this sphere. I can call this like, for example, M1, okay? And this part here that I call M2. This means that these hypersurfaces divide the sphere in two parts, okay? So consider omega I the union of one of these parts that sigma is dividing, okay? This is mi union sigma. So with this we have two domains with a boundary. Sigma is a common boundary for these two domains, okay? And the idea is apply the right identity for this domain. This is the domain with a boundary, okay? So, for this, we consider, okay, this is a domain in the sphere, okay? We consider a solution of the following problem. We try to get the Laplacian F equal 0 in this domain omega I, okay? And you take F equal G at the boundary, okay? Sigma, where G is the first eigenfunction associated to Laplacian bar, okay? We have the situation. So now we take this solution here and try to apply in this identity here, okay? So what you get here. First, the Laplacian here is zero, okay? The Laplacian in the omega I, in this case, is zero, so basically this became zero, okay? An observation that you did in the last class, we can also estimate this. This is a thing that you do in the last class. The Hessian F square is less or equal the Laplacian F. This by this. Okay? We have this also this important inequality. Okay? So also you can estimate this by zero. Okay? So now we have an inequality like this, okay? Okay. And you have this integral here, h, rate f, okay? And plus these things here. So let's replace the things. First, the h tensor of a sphere, we know what's the h tensor of a sphere. It's easy to get this h tensor. The h tensor of a sphere is n minus 1 g, okay? It's the h tensor because all the curvatures, the constant, the sectional curvatures are constant in the sphere. are the same at the same value. We are in the unidimensional sphere, so we have this situation. So basically, this is I n minus one g applied to grade f. So this is basically n minus one nor grade f square. Okay. And some situation that happens here. First, we are treating about minimum hypersurface. So h is zero, the mean curvature is zero. This doesn't appear. Okay. And also, I just put the here omega I, and here is sigma, okay? What happened here? Now, Laplacian bar F, I name it this situation here, okay? F is G, so Laplacian bar F is minus lambda 1 G, okay? So this is minus 2 lambda 1 g f nu, okay? Okay. Also, g appears here, okay? And what we can complete also here, what happens? Just a correct. This is F. It's correct here. Yeah. What happens? We have this second fundamental form here. Okay, so we can estimate also the second fundamental form in what way? Because depending of the domain here, this could be positive or negative. Okay, because we know that if you look for this function, for example, the normal, the stereo normal for this region is a thing like this, and the stereo normal for this region, this inky region, is this, okay? So, choosing the region such that this is greater or equal to zero, we can estimate also this by this value, okay? So, this is greater or equal the integral of omega I n minus 1 nor grade f square, okay? Just to complete here. Minus 2 lambda 1 g f nu in the boundary sigma, okay? Let's suppose, for example, that this happens in the boundary omega 1, okay? So we just need to treat with this term here, okay? But this term we can treat using the integration by parts. Why? Just let put something here. Here we have like f nu at the boundary, okay? And again, we can use the divergence of a right thing. For example, if you take the divergent of f grade f, okay, what is this? This is the divergent f divergent grade f, what means f Laplacian f, okay, plus grade f inner grade f. This means plus norm grade f square, okay? And since Laplacian f is zero in this domain, this is basically norm grade f square, okay? So what means this? This means that if you integrate here in the domain omega 1, for example, this divergent f grade f, this is equal the integral and the domain omega 1 norm grade f square, and you can use the divergence theorem here. And this is basically the same thing that appears here, okay? This is the integral at the boundary of omega 1, that is sigma f nu, okay? And just remember that f is equal to g at the boundary, okay? So basically here is g F nu. Okay? So basically it's the same thing that appears here. Okay? So basically this is norm grade F square. So we have a thing like this. This is equal N minus 1, okay, minus 2 lambda 1, integral of norm grade F square, okay? This is basically the conclusion, okay? Just erase here. Just to compare the calculation. And from this, easily obtain this estimate here, because we know that this has to be a non-positive term. So since this is non-negative, we have an estimate for here, okay? This is less or equal to zero. So lambda one has to be greater or equal n minus one by two, okay? This is more one application of Riley identity. It's okay. If you have some question, can write here. Just to talk about some words about this, the importance of this result, that's it's easy to obtain using the Riley identity. There is a long time conjecture, the Eyal's conjecture. That asks that in this situation the Percy eigenvalue has to be n minus one. Okay. And you know some examples of hypersurface where this is attaining. This is basically the first eigenvalue is n minus one. Okay. So this is a conjecture in this setting, okay, of minimal hypersurface in this sphere. Okay. Okay, so this is more application. So now I like to give other application, and now using the Heitz-Encarts inequality that you have obtained in the last class, okay? So just to remember some steps now. And now the goal is give a demonstration of the Florin theorem, that is the Alexandrov theorem. This is a very important theorem that says that if sigma, I put here, contained in the Euclidean space is an embedded, constant embedded and closed constant mean curvature happy surface then sigma is a sphere. Okay, this is very beautiful theorem here. Okay, and in some words, this is known like a sub-bubble result, because in fact, when you are studying sub-bubbles, there is some physical laws that says that, in fact, when we are studying sub-bubbles, we have some difference between depression, the inner pressure, and the outer pressure. Okay, if you limit by a sub bubble in a sense, and the difference between these two pressures, the inner and the outer, is something related with the mean curvature of this interface. Okay, this is some constant that depends of the material and times the mean curvature. So basically, if you are in a equilibrium situation, what means that you have this difference constant, we are still doing something like the constant mean curvatures. Okay, so this is the importance, for example, and this is because this theorem is not like a sub-bubble theorem. Okay, also like a sub-bubble theorem. Okay, so we need some steps because we know something that's good and characterize the sphere that you studied in the last class, that is the Heisenkärcher inequality. So just remember here. In the last class, we saw the Heisenkärcher inequality. Okay, in the Heisenkärcher inequality, we have something like this. The volume omega is less or equal n minus 1 by n, the integral of sigma 1 by h. Okay, and the situation is like we have a hypersurface, is precisely the situation here, hypersurface in the Euclidean space. Okay, and omega means the domain that is bounded by this hypersurface. This means that the boundary of omega is precisely sigma. Okay, so we have precisely the situation here. Okay, and what's more important, it's more important in the Heisenkärcher inequality, is that we can characterize when the equality holds. Okay. The equality holds if and only if omega is a ball and so sigma is a sphere. Okay, so this is a thing that you try to do. Is this? If you prove that the equality holds here, we prove that the main the hypersurface is a sphere. Okay, so to do this in this special case of constant mean curvature, we need some step more. And for this, we need the known Minkowski identity, okay? Okay. So what says the Minkowski identity? Basically says that n minus 1 area of sigma is equal to the integral of sigma h x nu, the sigma, okay, where x is the position vector field in the Euclidean space. Okay? So we have this situation, and this is known like the Minkowski identity. Okay? So, how we can demonstrate this? We need some steps here, okay? So I'm basically in this situation when I have a hypersurface in the Euclidean space. This is the position. This means this is the vector that represents the position here, x1, x2, xn, okay? And for this, we have this entire situation here, okay? So what you need are some steps. First step, we can prove that the grid bar of norm x square is the tangent part of x, okay? And we can prove this easily, okay? And how we can prove this? Basically, just remember this is the connection in the hypersurface, okay? It's the connection in the hypersurface. So I think that we could do is we take if E while is a field in the hypersurface, what happens if you take grid bar, norm x square, while, for all while. By definition of grade, the gradient, this is while applied to the norm, okay, x square, okay? So basically this is while applied to x, okay? Here I have two, just an observation. So this is two times grade while x, okay? And we have a very known property that this position vector has the property that if you take the grade, this is the gradient, the Euclidean gradient, this is grade x while is while, okay? So basically this is two, the inner product between while and x, okay? And just to conclude here, since this is a tangent vector field, this is equal to 2 times while and the tangent part of x, because the normal part with while is 0, okay? This inner product. So what does this imply? First, this implies that grade bar x square while is equal to 2 tangent part of x while, okay? This is for all while, so this implies our thesis. This means grad bar x square is 2 times the tangent part of x, okay? I'm giving some details of this proof, but just note that this is a very important thing to give this identity here, okay? This property that in the Euclidean space, there is a closed conformal vector field, a closed conformal vector field, what means that we have this property here, okay? Okay, so from this, other thing that we can do here, is take the Laplacian, okay? Let's just see what happens with the Laplacian of norm square. So Laplacian bar x square, what is this? This is the div bar of grade bar norm x square, okay? This is the definition of Laplacian, okay? So basically, this is the divergence bar of the following field that you know now. It's the tangent part of x, okay? So punctually, we can do that account to take the divergence. This is the sum, e equal 1 to n minus 1, and take here the bar ei, the tangent part, ei, okay? Where ei is a basis for the tangent space in a point, okay? From here, I can do this punctually, so this is a point in sigma, and here ei is a point in the tangent space to sigma at t. Okay, so what I can do here, easily, and do the following thing. This is e for 1 to n minus 1. Just observation again, I can do this 1/2, just to normalize the things, okay? and this is one half of his, this is one half of this, and one half of this graded bar is basically this tangent part here, okay? So here I have graded bar EI, and the tangent pates, the tangent part of X is X minus the normal part, okay? EI, okay? It's just by this decomposition. And field, I can write like its tangent part plus the normal part, that basically is X normal, normal, okay? Okay, so what I can do here, this is the sum, equal 1 and minus 1. Here, I have grade bar EI X EI, okay? This is the first part. And in the second one, I have minus. I do a fast count now, just to understand. Here I have first grid bar EI X nu nu inner EI. Okay. Just let's analyze this part here. What happens? First I have to derivate this function here. Okay. And after take the inner product between nu, the normal, and the EI. But this is normal and this is tangent. So the first part, the first derivative of this function, and after take the inner product, this is zero, okay? And after I have to take this inner product and take the derivative of the normal and inner EI, okay? So I write in this way. The only term that remains here is X normal D bar EI normal EI, okay? And like in the last class, this is basically the second fundamental form applied to this orthonormal base. We're taking this trace here, so this basically is the curvature, okay? The mean curvature. So just two observations. First, this is, since X is the position vector, this is EI, okay? So I have EI, EI, that is one, and I'm sum n minus one times. So this is n minus one, okay? Just observation, here is the connection bar, but I can put the connection, the whole connection to do the account, okay? And here I have minus X nu h, okay? So basically we have this account here. One half Laplacian bar of x square is this, okay? So for obtain this here, I just need to integrate, okay? Because if I integrate in sigma here, just remember that sigma is a closed hypersurface, so sigma has no boundary, and if you integrate here, in the side here, okay, we basically obtain that this is zero, because sigma has no boundary, and here we have n minus one, the area sigma, minus the integral of this. That's basically what appears here, okay? So for this, we can conclude this Minkowski identity, okay? And in some steps, how we can prove now the Aleksandrov theorem. Prove Aleksandrov theorem. Okay, just remember, we have a closed hypersurface in the Euclidean space with constant mean curvature, okay? And we'd like to prove that this hypersurface has to be a sphere, okay? If you prove the equality here, we are done by the equality case in the Heitzenkashi inequality, okay? So this is what we try to prove. So what to do is the following. We can, for example, initiate with this here. Okay. So basically, we have n minus 1 by n integral sigma, 1 by h sigma. And we have constant mean curvature, so we can take out these ones by h here. So this is n minus 1 by n, 1 by h. And here we have just the area, sigma. Okay, so we have this. Now, what we can use? Now, we can use the Minkowski identity. The Minkowski identity gives some relation between the area of sigma and other integral here. Okay, so basically this is n minus 1 by n, 1 by h, and by Minkowski identity, this is 1 by n minus 1, okay? And the integral of sigma h x nu, okay? We have the situation, basically the situation. We can use again that the mean curvature is constant, because if the mean curvature is constant, what happens here? This h comes out here, okay? So we can simplify this h with this h here, okay? Also, we can simplify this n minus 1 with this n minus 1, okay? So basically, we have this. This is 1 by n integral of sigma, the position vector, inner the normal, okay? The stereo normal, okay? Okay, so how we conclude here? We have the following. Remember the divergence theorem here, applied to the position vector, okay? This is, by divergence theorem, the integral in the whole domain of the divergent of this vector position. Okay? Position vector. Observation here, and we do in some step, what is the divergence of the position vector? Just remember, punctually, this is the sum, E equal 1, n, because you are in the whole manifold, this is the divergence in the whole manifold, and we have to take great EI x inner DI, okay? So what's this? This is the sum equal 1 to n. This is EI, EI, because x is the position vector field, okay? So this sum here in the whole manifold is n, okay? The divergence of the position vector is that. So this is n, okay? So we have 1 by n volume omega, okay? We simplify here and obtain that this is equal the volume omega, okay? So what's the conclusion? The conclusion here is this here, n minus 1 by n, this integral here, is equal to the volume of omega. So this implies that the equality holds here in the Heitz-Encarts inequality. And how we discussed in the last class, this means that the manifold, the hypersurface has to be a sphere, okay? So what's the message here? We try to get first an inequality, a Riemann inequality that directly comes from the height identity, that is this Heitz-Encarts inequality. And from this, we try to obtain a characterization of the equality. And for this characterization, we need one more step, that is this Minkowski identity, okay? So it's like Minkowski then control one part of the rigidity and Heitz-Encarts control another part of the rigidity, okay? But the equality holds, and just because we need to use something like this, okay? This also gives some message for the future and basically for the last class that if you need to get some rigidity results in the same sense for Riemannian manifolds, we need some properties like this, okay? So what is important to obtain the Minkowski identity is basically this property that you have a field, a special field with some properties, okay? In this case, the position vector field has these properties, okay? The property that you use a lot here, okay? And the Rigidity identity is useful to obtain some type of inequalities and characterize, in fact, the equality case as the Rigidity model, okay? Okay. I just would like to emphasize that, in fact, when I'm talking about the Alexandrov theorem, we have basically two non-proofs. The first proof is by the Allan Alexandrov when he used the moving planes method, okay? And basically, he used some Maxwell principles to prove some symmetry by the domain. And basically, this is a method that could be applied also in partial differential equation to get some symmetry results, okay? And this proof is basically use some theory by Riley, the own Riley that used the identity, and basically Ross, okay? The second proof that you use integral identity that I talk in this course is the proof by Riley Ross, okay? And basically use this stuff of geometric identities, okay? So, now, after do this Alexandrov theorem, this is a Rigidity result, a very beautiful Rigidity result, I will approach other problem here. That's known like Sarin's problem, okay? Also is a rigid problem. And also is inspired by physics, okay? Basically, the situation is the following. It's about that second question that I did yesterday. What in general we think that pipes has to be cylindrical? So the situation is this. Imagine that you have here like a tube, okay? And in this tube, we are moving some fluid here, okay? Along this tube. And by some properties, we want to discover what's the best format for the sections of this tube, okay? So imagine that you have a fluid that flows in straight lines here. And the situation is that we want to study what's the best shape for this section here, okay? This section of the tube, okay? And basically we have some physical equations that explain the situation. And basically what's important here is to study some equations of the velocity in this fluid, okay? So, for example, if a function u represent the velocity of the fluid, basically, we have some equation that the velocity satisfies. If you have, for example, an incompressible fluid, the Laplacian of the velocity is a constant. This is a constant that depends on the incompressibility of the fluid and some things more, okay? And basically, we can put some conditions about the boundary of this section. So now I'm talking about the boundary of omega, okay? Boundary of omega is the boundary of this section, okay? And here, I know this domain of omega, okay? That could be understand like a domain in the two-dimensional Euclidean space, for example, just for simplicity. Okay, so this is the equation that is explain the movement of the fluid, and you try to put two conditions at the boundary, okay? And has some reason for to put these conditions. The first one, that's known like this has to happen in the whole domain. The first condition is the adherence condition. This has to happen on the boundary, okay? So this means that the velocity of the fluid has to be zero at the walls of the tube, okay? And other condition that you can put here is something that's related with the tangential stress, okay? So the normal derivative is a thing that is related with the tangential stress of the fluid in the walls of this pipe, okay? So if you want that the if you want to get some constant tangent stress in this pipe, we ask for a condition of the normal derivative be a constant, okay? So I put here, this is a constant on the boundary, okay? So basically this is a problem that is inspired in this situation, okay? Basically in this situation. And in fact, this is a problem proposed by a physics to Sarin, okay? And Sarin tried to approach this problem and discover some things about this problem, okay? So basically, this is a work for, I think, in this year here, okay? And basically, Sarin tried to approach the following problem. The problem is Laplacian u equal minus one in a domain, and we have two conditions, u zero at the boundary, that's the adherence condition, and you have that the normal derivative here is equal a constant on the boundary, okay? What's interesting to talk about this problem also is the following. It's common to study just this problem here, that is a type of Poisson equation, okay? A problem with a Dirichlet condition, okay? And also it's common to study the first equation and the third equation, okay? It's a normal problem. So one thing that you know is that if you have a domain in the Euclidean space, for example, we can get for this domain, a smooth domain, a solution for this or a solution for this, okay? Separately, we can get solution for this problem. But the question is, if you put at the same time the two conditions, what happens with the domain, okay? This is a thing. Just to give an example here. Example solution, expected that the ball is a solution for this. So let's put, for example, let's take omega like a ball, okay, of center is zero in radius r, okay, zero is associated with this, I will see, and take the function u of x equal r square minus norm r square by 2n, okay? I'm just think about the Euclidean case. So here, omega is a domain in the Euclidean space, okay? So it's easy to see some things about the solution here. For example, the gradient of this is minus x by n, okay? And also it's easy to get the Laplacian of this here, because the Hessian is diagonal matrix here. It's easy to get the Laplacian here is equal minus one for the solution, okay? Also, it's easy to get the normal derivative here, because the normal here? Just a think. The normal derivative here is grade U, inner the normal, okay? And the normal, if I take the exterior normal here, and since this is a level set of zero, this is grade U minus grade U by norm grade U, okay? This is the normal derivative in this case, so we have a relation between the normal derivative and the norm of the gradient, okay? We have the situation here. So basically, if you take the norm here, this is norm x by n, okay? So basically, at the boundary, this is r, okay? Because the norm of x is r at the boundary. So, U nu is equal minus norm grade U. U nu, so on the boundary, U nu, that is this. This is equal R by N, okay? Also, this is a reason because I put here this minus sign. Okay, because if you are talking about the exterior normal vector field, basically this is minus the norm of grade U. Okay, this is a reason. Okay, so we have this relation. So basically, if you choose R like T times N, we get basically that this is a solution for this problem here. Okay, so at the beginning I can put here R equal Gn. The G is associated with this condition here, okay? So basically, this is a solution for a problem. Also, it's easy to see that U is zero at the boundary because at the boundary, norm X is R. So this is zero, okay? And this is what you talk about a radial solution because this solution depends on the radius, okay? It's a function that depends on the norm. So this is a solution, and what's interesting here is that we have a theorem by Serin in the same paper that this says that the only solution of this problem here, I'll talk the Serin problem, translations, because you can translate here and also obtain all the solutions, those translations. Is this B zero R with that radius and the solution UX equal square minus this by 2n, okay? So this is the only solution. But this is an interesting fact because, like I say, if you take just the problem, this true first equation, which also have a solution for all domains, and if you take the 1 and 3 also have solutions, but if you take the two conditions at the same time, we just have this solution. Okay, and an important thing here is that to demonstrate this result, Serin using the Aleksandrov moving planes. This is the first method that Aleksandrov demonstrate his theorem, okay? So the idea, and this is a very general fact for study symmetries or symmetry of some domains that are solution of some equations. The moving planes method works, okay? It's not so easy to work with this method, but in general, we can use this moving plane method to approach some symmetry results also for equations. And I think that this is the first time that one person applied this method, this geometric method, to approach some formats of solutions and also of domains. And basically, this is the method that Seren demonstrated his theorem. Okay. But what I like to talk between, because this is a course about integral identities, is that there is an alternative proof of this result, and it's interesting because in the same edition of the same journal that Seren published this paper, I think in the next space, we have a new proof given by Weinberger, okay? And this is the proof that I'll talk in this class. So Weinberger, in the same year, back in the same journal, prove the same result, but using other technique, okay? And what's the idea of Weinberger to prove a result like this? This is to prove the rigidity of the ball for the solutions here. The idea is the following. And this is known like the P-function methods. Okay. So the idea is the following. We have to consider a function associated with this problem here. Okay. So the idea is consider P of U, the following function, norm grad U square plus 2 by n u, okay? So we can consider this, where u is a solution of the Seren problem, okay? We have to admit this. So we can take the Laplacian of this function here. What happens with the Laplacian of this p function here? This is the Laplacian of norm grad u square plus 2 by n Laplacian u, okay? Using the Bochner formula, for example, but we are in the Euclidean case, just remember the Bochner formula, what says? 1/2 Laplacian norm grad u square is norm Hessian u square plus h grad u plus grad Laplacian u grad u, okay? In the Euclidean case, what happens? The h here is zero, and the gradient of Laplacian is zero because the Laplacian of u is a constant, okay? So basically, this here, Laplacian of grad u square, is 2 times the norm of Hessian u square, okay? So we have this, 2 times Hessian u square, and remember that Laplacian u is -1, okay? So this is -2 by n, okay? And also, we can do something here. This is -2 by n, Laplacian u square, okay? We can do this because the Laplacian u square is basically 1, okay? And the Laplacian u is -1. You are using the equation, just the equation, okay? So this is 2 times norm Hessian u square -1 by n Laplacian u square, okay? We have this here. And we can remember the last class. What happened in the last class? We have an inequality regarding this here. We know that by the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, okay, this is greater or equal to zero, okay? This is by Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, in the same way that you prove the inequality of Hatzenkartra. And also, the equality here holds if and only if the Hessian of u is a multiple of the identity, and in the case that the u is zero at the boundary, this implies that the domain has to be a sphere, okay? So the thing is, if you prove that this is equal, so we are done, okay? We know that the domain has to be, the boundary has to be a sphere, so the domain has to be a ball, okay? But what's important also in this characterization? This B function, just talking about a simple maximal principle, this B function is a function that is subharmonic, okay? The Laplacian PU is greater or equal to zero, okay? So we have two situations here, just applying the classical maximal principle. So since PU is subharmonic, we have two situations. Or PU is equal, what's the value of PDU in the boundary? PU restricted to the boundary, okay? What is norm radio is equal, norm radio square is equal to u nu square, so is equal to chi square, and u at the boundary is zero. So this restrict to the boundary is chi square, okay? So we have two situations, or PU is equal to chi square in the whole manifold, okay? Or PU is less than chi square in omega, okay? This is basically the maximum principle. Since PU is a subharmonic function, the maximum has to happen at the boundary unless P is constant, okay? So in other words, in order to prove that the Laplacian PU is constant, is zero, we can prove that if this happens, if PU is constant, okay, this constant here, the Laplacian is zero, so the equality happens here, and we have the rigidity result, okay? So this is what we try to do now, prove that in fact, with this hypothesis, the P function, this P function is constant, okay? And to do this, we need one identity, that is the Pohosaev identity that I'll demonstrate now, okay? If you have some questions, you can write in the chat. Okay, so basically with this analysis, we have the following thing. Or we have this, or we have this, okay? We just have these two options. We work now to get that this is not possible if you are in this situation, okay? So, so in order to get this, we demonstrate the Pohosaev identity. It's a very important identity here. What is the Pohosaev identity? So let G be a continuous function. Okay, and let G U be the integral of 0 to U of GS DS, okay? So if you have some regularity here, U C2 omega bar in a see you until the boundary. If this is a solution of point problem,
Laplace nu equal
minus du. This is in this domain. And u is zero at the boundary. Okay. Then we have identity. It is this. I minus 2 by 2 integral norm grid u square omega plus 1 half integral boundary here x nu norm grid u square. This is equal to n integral omega du. Okay. This is the identity. Okay, so this identity here that you are seeing, this is the Pohosaev identity. So this is identity that can apply in this situation when you have a solution of a problem like this. Okay, so in any moment that you have a solution of a problem like this, you have this identity here. So I will prove because it's more an application of divergence theorems. So interesting way to apply the divergence theorem. Okay. So let's prove this result here. Again, just to make clear here, okay, this is the exterior normal, okay. This x is the position vector again, so it's the same position vector that I talk in the class today, okay. This is the gradient, this is this g here, it's like a primitive of this function here, okay. So the idea is use the divergence theorem, okay, in the right way. So choose an interesting field here. So let's consider the following field W like grade U and the inner product between X grade U. Okay. Let's consider this field here. So first, let's take the divergence of this field. What is the divergence of W? Okay. Again, using the properties of the divergence. So this is the divergence of this field here. The divergence of the gradient is the Laplacian. Okay. Plus this field inner the gradient of this. X gradient X grade U. Okay. This property of the divergence. Okay. So let's work a few with this here. Who is X grade X grade U? Okay. By the definition of gradient, this is basically just a thing here. No. Grade U, sorry. This is grade U and this, okay, sorry. So this is grade U. Okay, so by the definition of gradient, this is this field grade U applied to X grade U, right? But this is what you use, that this is grade U X grade U plus X grade U. Okay? Let's use some property. The property that you use here, what is? X is the position vector field, so this is grade U. Okay? That property that I talk in this class. So this is grade U. Well, what is this? This is the Hessian U, okay? Hessian U, X grade U. This I just like to put in this way because this Hessian U of grade U X, but since this is symmetric, this Hessian U of X grade U, Okay? So basically, this is the norm of grid U square. And here, using again the definition of the Hessian, this is grid X, grid U, grid U. Okay? This is the definition of the Hessian. So basically, this is, we can write here like 1/2 X norm grid U square. Okay? It's just a small count here, okay? Because if you take out this, this is like 2 times this derivative here. Okay, so we can write in this way. This is Laplacian U, that in our case is minus GU, X grid U. And from here, we have 2 terms. We have norm grid U square plus 1/2. I can write also in this way. X grid norm grid U square is the same. This is the same that this, but the definition of a gradient, okay? Okay, so let's integrate, okay? And use integration by parts. Then, what's the integrate in omega of divergence W, okay? This is minus integral GU X grid U. This is in omega, plus the integral in omega norm grid U square, plus 1/2 integral omega X grid norm grid U square. Okay? So let's work a few in these terms. Okay, I work a few in this term here that I name 1 and this same here that I name 2. Okay? Well, the first thing here is how I can work with this term here, 1. The integral in omega of X G U grid U, okay? Just by definition of G, okay? If you derivate this G prime U, basically is G U grid U, okay? So basically, there we can see G prime U, okay? So basically here we have X GU grid U is the same thing that integral omega of X grid GU, okay? This big G, okay? Here I just use basically integration by parts. I just use the fundamental theorems of calculus, okay? And what happens when I can approach this term here? Record the divergence of X GU. Okay, what's this? Using again that properties of divergence. This is the divergent of X G U, okay, plus the inner product between X and grid G U. Okay. So if I integrate by parts, this is What's this? This is the integral at the boundary of x, g, u. Okay. I take the integral of the divergence. So this is this inner the normal. Okay. Let's just put here g, u, x normal. Okay. Minus this here. Okay. Minus the integral of omega divergent x g u. Okay? I'm just replacing this by the integral of this, and I already used the integration by part theorem minus this here. Okay? Let's just erase here. Okay? And give some considerations. What happens? At the boundary, u is zero, okay? So what happens if u is zero here? If u is zero here, this is zero. Integral of zero to zero, okay? This is zero. So since u is zero at the boundary, this is zero, okay? And also, we have that the divergent of the position vector is m. So this becomes minus n gu, okay, in the domain. So in a way, we control this term, okay? And let's also work with two in the same way, okay? You maintain this along the course. So now we have x grid norm grid u square. So let's take the divergence of x norm grid u square, okay? What is this? This is the divergent x norm grid u square, okay? Plus x grid norm grid u square, okay? So this implies, integrating by parts, that the integral of x grad norm grad u square, this is equal to, integrating by part here, we have integral at the boundary of x norm grad u square, x nu, minus the integral in omega divergent x norm grad u square, okay? So we have this. So basically, we can repeat this term here, okay? Norm grad u square x nu, and the divergent of x is n. So this is minus n integral omega norm grad u square, okay? Just integration by parts. Okay, so we can replace these two informations here, okay, one and two. So one, we have this minus sign here, so we can replace by this with the positive sign. So this is n integral omega g u, okay? So I erase here. Okay, one term that appears there, okay? And I have this term here, again. And this term here, just remember that you have this one half, okay? So this is minus, let's put here, minus n by two integral omega norm grad u square, okay? And plus one half integral at the boundary of norm grad u square x nu. Okay? So from this divergent, we have this. And let's continue here. Okay. So the intention is use the divergence theorem. So we know what's the field. Okay? The field is this, is grad u x grid U, okay? And we know by the divergence theorem that the integral of the divergent W is the integral at the boundary of the inner product between W and the external normal vector field, okay? The unit one. Okay, so we already evaluated this, so we have to evaluate this part here. This is easy to do because the integral of the boundary W nu, this is equal to integral at the boundary. This is the field, so this is X grad U, grad U inner the normal, and this is basically U normal, okay? And basically we have to see that this is equal to this. It's not difficult to see this, because basically the normal, the integral normal is this, because we have a level set, is grad U by normal, grad U, okay? Also we saw that the normal derivative of a function with that properties is minus the norm of grad U, okay? So basically this is integral of the boundary. Here I have X, grad U is minus nu norm grad U, okay? And where we already see that U nu is minus norm grad U, okay? This is minus norm grad U. So basically, this is the integral at the boundary of X nu norm grad U square, okay? Exactly the same boundary term that appears here, okay? It's important. Okay, so in one side we have that this is equal the integral norm grad U square X nu, okay? And we already know what happens here, okay? And just observe that we can sum these two terms here, and this is 2 minus n by 2 integral of norm grad U square, okay? So from this we have exactly this term here, okay? And also when we take this term here minus this term here, we get 1/2. 1 minus 1 by 2 is 1/2. That's basically what happens here. Okay? So with this, we can obtain this Pohozaev identity. If you have some question, you can write in the chat. Okay, so basically this is the Pohozaev identity. It's a very general identity that can use, okay? So, a corollary of this result. Is the following. In our specific case, so now we return for our equation. As remember, our starting problem is Laplacian U equals minus 1, U0 at the boundary, and the normal derivative is minus a constant at the boundary, okay? And what happens when you apply the Pohozaev identity for this specific equation? So the corollary is the following. If U is a solution of the serine problem. Then we have the following identity. N plus 2 by N integral omega norm grade U square. This is T square volume omega.
Okay.
So in this specific situation, we have this identity, okay? If you have a solution, you basically have this identity here. And it's just work something more, okay? Using the Pohosev identity, because what happens here? Now, we know that the normal derivative is constant, so the norm of grid U squared is constant. And also, we know what is this function G, big G U, okay? So let's just put this. In our case, G U, okay? What's G U in this particular case? G U is the integral 0 U, okay? And G is 1, okay? In our case, so this is 1. So G U is U, okay? So basically, here appears N U. Okay. So let's note that N integral omega G U is equal N integral omega U. Okay. And we also can get something more, because what is this? This is minus the integral omega U Laplacian U. What? Because Laplacian U is equal minus 1 in the domain, okay? And here we can use, again, integration by parts, because more time, use a lot of time this, but the divergence of U grade U, what is this? This is U Laplacian U plus grade U, norm grade U square. Okay? So if we integrate here, okay, this is integral omega of norm grade U square, okay, this minus sign, minus the integral in omega of the divergence U grade U, okay? This is basically also the green theorem, okay? But basically, I'm just forget the N here. I have an N here, and also an N here, okay? Okay, okay. So this is N integral omega norm grade U square, okay, minus divergence theorem here. The divergence of U grade U is the integral at the boundary of U U nu, okay? Because we put this at the boundary and this field inner the normal. Grade U inner the normal is the normal derivative, okay? But what happens here, that's interesting, U is zero at the boundary, okay? We use a lot this fact, so this is zero, okay? So basically, N G U is N norm grade U square, okay? So basically finish, because then applying Pohosev identity, what happens here? We have n minus 2 integral omega non grid U square. Just let I do here.
is here.
Okay, just to make clear.
Then by Pohozaev identity, what to have? Just looking for this identity here. N minus 2 by 2 integral omega norm grade u square. Okay. Here, what I have here? I have 1/2. This is norm grade u square is t square. So this is t square integral at the boundary of x nu. Okay, x nu, and this is n integral omega norm grade u square. This is what we see. Okay, so we just link the things here. So if you take this with this, we have in the side, you have 1/2 t square. Using the divergence theorem here, this is the integral of omega of divergent x, and like we did in the Minkowski identity, this is basically n, the volume of omega, okay? Because the divergent of x is n, okay? So here we have n volume omega, okay? And here we have n minus 2 minus m by 2 integral omega norm grade u square, okay? And we are basically done here, okay? Because this is two, and here I have n plus 2.
Yeah. Okay. Exactly. Exactly. Have this 2 n minus n plus 2 by 2. Okay. Integral omega norm grade u square. And this is basically this identity, okay? Because we can simplify this two here and divide n here, okay? Basically, it's this. So we have this identity applied for our problem, okay?
So, to conclude the Weinberger proof, what the situation? Now, we have this identity here, that basically is an application of the Pohozaev identity. In this case, okay, in the case of the serine problem, the specific serine problem. And we have that analysis by the p-function method, okay? So, just let's remember and conclude, okay? And this is the that I like to do today. So just remember how we start. We start with a function that depends on that problem. This is the function. Okay. We know that the Laplacian of this function is 2 times hash and u square plus minus Laplacian u square by n. We know this inequality here, okay? That comes from the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, so we can characterize when happens the equality. So, since this is a subharmonic function, we have two situations. Or this p-function
is a constant.
And the domain, okay.
Or the p function is less than t square in omega, okay? So let's suppose that this happens. The second thing happens,
okay? Suppose that the second situation, this is
pu is less than t square. So this implies that
norm grid u square plus 2 by n u is less than t square.
Okay? Let's integrate in omega. Okay? If we integrate in omega, we have that the norm of grid u square plus 2 by n integral omega u is less than t square integral omega. What means t square volume omega. Okay? And observe that you did in the last thing is if you have these conditions, the integral of u in omega is equal to integral of knob grid u square in omega. Okay? Basically, this is the thing that you did when we are to approach the integral of GU in the particular case of serine problem. Okay? And this is easy to see using the problem. Okay? So this is 2 by n integral omega norm grid u square. Okay? So this is less than this volume here. And what this implies, by the end, this implies that n plus 2 by n integral norm grid u square in omega is less than t square volume omega. Okay? This is the conclusion. But this is a contradiction by the Pohozaev identity, okay? So if you suppose that this happens, the Pohozaev identity gives a contradiction because this inequality implies this. What is a contradiction of this identity here, okay? So we just have one thing. So what's the conclusion by the Pohozaev identity? Therefore, these conditions cannot happen, okay? So the p function is constant in the whole domain. And in particular, Laplacian of a constant function is zero, okay? This implies that we have the equality here, okay? And in particular, the Hessian is a multiple of the identity, okay? Just remember that this equality here came from the equality in the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. So again, this is a thing that you can analyze the rigidity result, okay? Basically, is in the exactly same way that you analyze the rigidity of Heisenkarch inequality. So here, in the same way, this implies that you can classify what is U, and also you can classify what's the domain, okay? Basically, U, we can see that U is a quadratic polynomial, okay? Because Hessian U is a multiple of the identity. And also, since U is zero at the boundary, could classify that, in fact, the boundary has to be a sphere, okay? Basically, this is the thing. Omega, on the boundary of phi omega is a sphere. And in fact, this implies that the domain has to be a ball. Okay? So basically, this is the Weinberger's proof of the Sering problem. Okay, basically, there are two proofs in the same journal. The first one using moving planes, and the second one that used this integral technique. It's like a parallel between the Alexandrov proof or the Alexandrov theorem that I call today, and the Riley-Ross proof of the Alexandrov theorem. One used this moving planes method, okay, in both cases, Sering problem, Alexandrov theorem, and another one used the integral technique. So during this course, I trying to get this integral technique to give these results. Also because, just one observation, this is a general fact that I'd like to observe here. In both results, what are the things that happens? First, we have an inequality, okay? Some characterization of inequality. In the first problem, the Alexandrov theorem, in the way to demonstrate the Alexandrov theorem, we have the Heisenkärcher inequality, and you need something more to demonstrate the Rigidity result, okay? In that case of the Alexandrov theorem, we need the Minkowski identity, okay? And to demonstrate the Minkowski identity, we need some special property for a vector field, okay? That is position vector field, okay? And in this way, we have a similar situation in some sense, because first, just use some types of Maxwell principles, okay? We have two conditions, and we would like to exclude one condition, okay? And to exclude this condition, you use, again, one identity. In this case, is the Pohosaev identity. And some more thing, to demonstrate the Pohosaev identity, use also the property of the position vector field. Position vector field is a field with that properties, okay? And I think that in the last class, I tried to approach this type of theorems in general Riemannian manifolds, because the Alexandrov theorem that I demonstrate here and also the Sering rigidity theorem that I demonstrate here, in this case happens just for Euclidean domains, okay? But also I try to demonstrate or to give some directions to get extensions of these results in the setting of Riemannian manifolds, okay? So this is the content of the last class. Okay, so if you have some questions, we can write here. I think that for today we finish. If you have some questions, something to add to the class, we can write here or also open your microphone. Okay, but tomorrow we return with more summary results, okay?